What I've learned from him over these years is his ability to communicate between cultures. And that's why I was very, very glad that he accepted my invitation to make an inspiring, I hope it's inspiring, contribution on 5 minutes, okay, intercultural communication and its importance and its role in the context of an international university. So thank you.
Thank you. So I think I have to keep you awake. And I'll just look around the room. If you sleep, I'll point to you. You are sleeping. So. It's always a joy to be here and to share in this work, this tremendous work. I was telling someone, the first time I came to Albania, this was a bush, as we say it in Africa. And to see how this place is not just developing in structure, but also in building people, and as Roy had said before. But my role here is talk about the intercultural situation. As you can see, it's actually cultural. Africans don't do presentations on a PowerPoint, so I don't have one. So we like to narrate stories, you know. When I was dating my wife, whom most of you know, I used to be liked by a small girl, and her name was Francesca. And when she sees me, she will say, she'll go to her mom, and she was very shy. And she'll hold the mother's hand, and she'll say, Mom, why does Ahmed only wash inside his hands and not his own body? Now, I say that to tell you that culture, the word culture, exists, and yet it doesn't exist. It is a social construct. It is like the concept of race. There is no race. But we've all become so used to using the word race that we forget that we're all human beings. So when you talk about culture, we begin with from the basics that we are all human, that we are all people. Some of us wash inside our hands, and some of you don't have to wash at all, you know? So culture is so important to understand when you deal with people, especially today, where people are so interconnected. I was in Malta on Monday, then I was in Vienna for 2 days, met people from all over Africa and Europe, left at 10 o'clock, and at 2 a.m. I am here, and today I'm sharing with you here. I was going to say I was the only black person, but I don't take that credit. But at least in the brain, I was one of the only few African persons. And it becomes important to understand how we communicate with each other, how we talk to each other, especially in this growing multicultural, multidimensional world in which we live in. I often tell people, if you look at me, what would you say? When I go to a government office in Malta, the first thing people ask me is, it depends on the way I dress. So if you look at the Germans here, they are all wearing, most of them are wearing jeans and wearing a jacket and no tie. It has become so trendy in Germany. I can tell a German in this room in the way they dress, except our great parent, who is Albanian German. And culture has trends, it changes from time to time. But when people look at you, they tend to look at you based on how you look, especially being an African, being a black person. So when I go to a government office and someone looks at me, he says to me, what do you want? And then I look at them and I say, oh, but, so I turn to speak in Maltese. I tell them, I'm looking for this. Oh, so you speak Maltese? And I go, I don't just speak Maltese, I am Maltese. And they go, but where are you from? I told you I'm from Malta. But really, really, where are you from? Culture is a perception. And it has a tendency to color the way we view other people. And in an institution like this, it is very important for us to be conscious of that fact. A person is coming from Africa, a person is coming from Brazil, a person is coming from Albania, a person is coming from Germany. The Germans are the higher beings. What they do is the best. What they have is the best. Oh yeah. The Americans are always not the best, but they're the great. No. let me stop there. So, when we meet each other in this context of an international environment, what we tend to do is, we tend to view each other on the basis of culture, on the basis of our perceptions, on the basis of our prejudices. So let me talk about me being an African. Many Africans, if you talk to them and you plan things, and I've had this exchange with Arnold, and I've learned a lot from him in this, they'll tell you yes. You speak, they say yes. You want to do this? Yes. Because in our culture, saying no is disrespectful. It's a polite way. Most cultures in developing countries are relational. They are not outcomes. They are not achievements in terms of products. Whilst in the Western culture, people are in a hurry not to know you, but to see what you can give them or what they can get out of you. So there are obligations that you know, and this can be a problem in an international environment like this, when we're talking to each other. So when sometimes people say to me, I work a lot with refugees and migrants, and they tell me yes, so I ask them, yes, no, or yes, yes. Because the word yes can mean so many different things to so many people depending on the context. Yes. I understand, yes, I don't want to do it, yes, I'm being polite. So in a multicultural situation, you always have to listen and listen more. You always have to say, I don't understand, and to express that very clearly, because it's a challenge. There is something that is the way I view what you say. The second thing that I want to say is not just the language or how we understand things, but how we interpret things. The concept of success. I was speaking to Arlinda earlier on, and this was part of our discussions in Vienna, how we are going to leverage the remittances of African diaspora like us who are remitting money to families, which has become a huge development aid package. You know, last year Africa got 65 billion euros in remittances by migrants. Probably Albania is almost higher in their GDP contribution by remittances. Development aid amounted to 6 billion. That is 10 times more. But if you see, most development aid funding is implemented by development aid agencies because they lack trust. BMZ will not support a local agency to implement a development project, but they would rather give it to GIZ to do that. And usually it comes from the way of mistrust. And mistrust comes from understanding what is best for the other. And this happens always in a multicultural environment. A student, I've always had this. Let's say our Albanian students and our African students. An Albanian student will do the bare minimum. It is a generalization. And the culture will be, the African is taught to achieve, so it's always greedy. That can bring jealousy, it can bring conflict within that environment. Because one has been taught that even the fact that the African is coming here because he's being supported to study, cultivate a habit of overachievement. Because the Albanian has to contribute something, I am paying for what I have. So in the classroom, there can be a cultural dynamic. What happens if the African student succeeds and the Albanian student doesn't succeed, or the other way around? It can create a conflict. I've often had a problem where I am a European, where I listen to others, but whenever I challenge people, they'll tell me, go back to Africa and go and challenge the people. It is a perception, it is an understanding. You, as an African person, cannot challenge me in my own country, in my own continent, as a European. I will accept you if you always behind me. I will accept you if you always accept what I say. But the moment you take leadership and authority, I don't accept you. Who are you? So what will happen if we create this multinational, multicultural environment where people who are not Albanians rise up to positions of authority and positions of leadership? What will happen? And this we have to be aware. But these are the challenges. What are the benefits? The benefits is that, you know, God didn't make the rainbow for nothing. Wherever there is a multicultural environment, there is enrichment that you receive when you open to learn. When I met our taxi driver last night, all I said to him is, "Sieni, mira?" And his face was, "Wow, that guy, he speaks Albanian." I told him, "Don't go too far, that's all." Story. I was in Greece, Athens, and we went out to, with a group of friends, to a nightclub. A nightclub? Because we went out as a group, you know, and it was a bar in the middle of Athens. And this woman, I heard her speak to someone in Albanian. And I go, "Wow, she's Albanian." So I go to her, I told her, "Sieni, mira?" And she turned, she got me, "An African man who speaks cheap." You know, that whole evening, I had the best treatment in that place because I managed to say, "Sieni, mira?" And that was all. She called her uncle and she called her cousin. All the wine I had that night was free. And you know what? They were happy that I come from Pogradec because she was from Pogradec. She knows the MI gateway. And one of them was a student at the MI school. So you see how enriching culture can be. I met her, not in Albania, I met her in Greece. Athens. And that is the enrichment that we can get when we allow this university to enhance all the cultures that are represented in this room. I can look at you, I remember the first time I came here, I can look at Albania and say, my second country is Albania. You know, that I have brothers, that I have sisters, that I have aunties and uncles, and people tell me, "You're joking," and I go, "No, I am not joking, I mean it." Because when I come here, I learn so much from you guys. And I think that Nehemiah Gateway provides this platform, as we discussed this morning, for this cultural exchange and enrichment. And I'm very glad that I can come here and be a part of that. I am sorry that I couldn't come yesterday, but I could not miss this for the world. And it is always a joy to have Elis as my small boy now. I told him this morning, in Africa, if you take over someone, you call them a small boy. So I told him, if there's any way that we can support you, then it is our joy. Thank you so much for having me for these few minutes. Thank you.